good evening. Welcome, everybody, to this memorial for Robert and Joyce Fraley. It is in this time that we're in, where we can't all gather together, it is such a blessing to be able to see so many of you here this evening. It really, really means a lot to our families to see so many. I see so many faces of people I haven't seen in a long time. And it's a testament to the impact that both my grandfather, Robert, and Joyce had on so many different people's lives. It is wonderful to see you. This is, without a doubt, a celebration of two people who lived faithfully to the call of the Spirit on their life to, well, to be people who ushered in just as much as they possibly can, bits and pieces of the kingdom of God. These are two faithful, loving, wonderful human beings who are in glory with the Lord. And we come to celebrate their life. And this evening, I anticipate a few tears, some laughing, and just, to be reminded and seeing all of your faces, the impact that these two made on so many different people. So this evening, we're going to start first with the reading of the obituary. And that's going to be done by Joyce's daughter, Sharon. Sharon's going to go ahead and read that obituary right now.
Joyce Marie Owens Hall Baxter Fraley. She was born May 20th, 1928 in Ranger, Texas, and she died January 22nd, 2021 in Tampa, Florida. Who was this lady, and how did she live her 92 years? Well, she was well-educated, and she loved books. She earned a bachelor's in English literature from Cal State Fullerton and a master's in elementary education from the University of Alaska. She was a terrific first-grade teacher, most recently at the Oak Harbor Public Schools on beautiful Whidbey Island, Washington. If you were in first or second grade there between the years of 89 and 1994, she may have taught you to read. She was a faithful and lifelong Christian, worshiping at the South Whidbey Church of Christ and in her later years at the Oak Harbor Church of Christ, where she could often be found in a Sunday school classroom or helping with Vacation Bible School. If you were there between 83 and 2003, she may have taught you to pray and to trust in the Lord. She was a wonderful wife and mother, and she proved that three times. She married for the first time at age 19 to Alton Hall, who was in the ministerial program at Abilene Christian College. Joyce had three children with her first husband, Sharon Hall Porter, of Whidbey Island, Washington, and Honolulu, Hawaii, Judy Hall Moravli of Tampa, Florida, and Charles Allen Hall of Homer, Alaska. One of the many adventures and daring plans she was to become involved with occurred when she and Alton bought an old 1920s schoolhouse in Moreno Valley, California, which they totally restored. She lost her first husband in 1972. In 1973, Joyce married a second time to Major James A. Baxter, U.S. Army, retired. She lovingly welcomed Jim's four children into her life, Anella, Patricia, James Jr., and Roberta. The second great adventure of Mom's life involved building from the keel up a beautiful sailboat, which they named Gemini. It was completed in the late 80s after 7 years of work, and they set sail. Involved in the 100-year storm in Cabo San Lucas, their beautiful creation was pitch-pulled up onto the sand and left in ruin. They didn't let it get them down. They went on to what they called Plan B. They bought a large motorhome and spent many years roaming the country and seeing the sights. Willie Nelson's On the Road Again, playing on the stereo in the cabin. In 1983, her daughter Sharon and husband Dick asked them to settle down in a beautiful little cabin on Smuggler's Cove Road in Greenbank, and they lived on that property for 12 years before moving to Oak Harbor, where Jim died in 2002. In 2003, after the passing of Louise Fraley and Jim Baxter, Bob Fraley was asked to deliver the Sunday sermon at the South Whitby Church of Christ. Her daughter, Sharon, sat down at the end of the row next to her mother, Joyce, who leaned over and whispered, "Don't sit there. Bob might want to sit there." Not surprisingly, Joyce and Bob were married soon after at the Oak Harbor Church of Christ. We were pleased for them, but we privately thought, wow, 75 and 79, why are they getting married? How foolish we were. Joyce again welcomed children into her heart with the inclusion of Bob's three daughters, Bobby, Rita, and Debbie. Joyce and Bob continued to serve their church and love all the children and grandchildren. They took care of each other to the end. Joyce passed away on the night of the morning of January 22nd, actually about 12:15 in the morning. Bob and Joyce got 17 years of love and laughter and companionship from the big chance they took late in life. If you were fortunate to witness this, you would join us all in saying farewell to a great lady. She always voted for love and taught us to give with our whole hearts. But in her book, when it came to love, you better be married. Thank you.
Next up, my mom, Roberta Isbell Fraley, is going to read the obituary for Robert Fraley.
Robert Leland Fraley was born December 10th, 1923 in Akron, Ohio, to Mildred Pryor and Herschel C. Fraley. He was the first of three children, Betty Fraley Vinoy and Carolyn Fraley Morrison. Robert and his wife of 17 years, Joyce Owens Fraley, passed away peacefully a few hours apart. She in the evening of January 21st and he on the morning of January 22nd, 2021. After contracting the COVID-19 virus. Bob grew up in Northern Ohio during the years of the Depression. He learned carpentry and construction skills by working alongside his father. He learned music skills by accompanying his father to various churches to hold music schools. And he learned the art of basic automobile mechanics by working on his beloved Model A Ford. His entire family were committed Christians. His father and grandfathers all served as elders in their local congregations. He enlisted in the Army in 1943, took his training in Seattle, and served in the India, Burma, China, and North African theaters. While in the service, Bob narrowly escaped death many times. His regiment loaded onto His Majesty's transport ship, the Rona, in Oran, Algeria, only to be transferred off the vessel hours before the Rona left port and was sunk in the Mediterranean by a Luftwaffe Hinkel heavy bomber. These experiences profoundly shaped his theological understanding of the providence of God and cemented his view that God causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Matthew 5:45a. At the end of World War II, Bob met Nyla Louise Irvin, and the two fell in love and married on October the 17th, 1946. Using the GI Bill, Bob enrolled at Abilene Christian College in 1947 to pursue an undergraduate degree in Bible. While at ACC, Bob and Louise had Roberta Bobby Louise Fraley in March 1949. In January 1954, they adopted 11-day-old Deborah Ann Fraley, and their family was completed when Louise gave birth to their youngest daughter, Rita Lee Fraley, in November 1957. After receiving his degree, Bob became the local minister in Ironton, Ohio. He continued to serve the church as a preacher, teacher, deacon, and elder for the next 50 years. He continued his seminary studies at Trinity Lutheran Seminary and at Pepperdine University. Bob eventually served as a minister at Churches of Christ in Ohio, California, Tennessee, and Washington State. In 1967, Bob accepted Norval Young's offer to work as a student recruiter for Pepperdine University in Los Angeles, California. He became dean of admissions when the university moved to the new campus in Malibu and led the admissions department until his retirement in 1989. Upon retiring, Bob and Louise moved to Woodinville, Washington, to be near Bobby and her children, Jason, Beth, Matt, and Ian. After 10 years in Washington, they felt the need to be near their younger daughter, Rita, and her little girls, Brittany and Kelly, so they relocated to Texas. Louise was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, which finally took her life March 1st, 2003, at their home in Bay City, Texas. Bob was heartbroken by her passing and returned to Washington State to mourn the loss with Bobby and her family. That summer was spent working as a handyman and consultant at Camp Shiloh in New York. At the end of camp back in Washington, Bob was a guest preacher at the South Whidbey Church of Christ, and there he reconnected with Joyce Owens Baxter, a recent widow whom he had met previously. The two decided life was too short to be alone, and they married in Oak Harbor, Washington. Bob and Joyce moved to Bay City to be near Rita and remained there until Rita passed away from lung cancer in 2015 at the age of 57. Upon Rita's passing, Bob and Joyce moved to Joliet, Illinois to live with Joyce's daughter, Judy, and her husband, Tony Mrovley. Well, the temptation to live on a farm was too great, and farm in quotes, was too great as Bob and Joyce took up residence with Bobby in New Jersey, where they raised chickens, helped feed and water the horse, and rode around in the Cub Cadet. In 2018, Bob and Joyce moved to a retirement facility in Tampa, Florida, where they remained until their passing. They were lovingly cared for by Judy, Maggie Santana, a host of health aides and nurses, doctors, and cooks. Bob leaves behind a sister, Carolyn Morrison of Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio, his daughters, Bobby Isbell of Stillwater, New Jersey, and Debbie Fraley of West Milford, New Jersey. Bob is survived by six grandchildren, Jason Isbell of the Bronx, New York, Elizabeth Baker of Montclair, New Jersey, Matthew Isbell of Topanga Canyon, California, Ian Vidrine Isbell of La Mirada, California, Brittany Acosta, of Austin, Texas, and Kelly Maxey of Hattiesburg, Mississippi, and their spouses, Allison, Brandon, Kelly, Bonnie, Nick, and Seth. Bob leaves behind 14 great-grandchildren, Levi, Zeke, Sam, Nyla, Zoe, Ronan, Isla, Ruby, Rosemarie, Ben, Lucas, Luisa, Magnolia, and Molly. We join in mourning with the hundreds of thousands of other Americans who have lost family members to COVID-19. We take comfort in Bob and Joyce's peaceful passing together. We shed tears of gratitude for Bob's life, a life lived in humor, integrity, fidelity, service, and most importantly, faith. Because of him, we are confident in the promise of God that the Lord does not slumber nor sleep, and neither does Bob. Thank you.
Thank you, Mom. Great job, by the way. Wow. Awesome. And now I'd like to welcome Nick Acosta, who is married to Brittany Acosta, and he's going to deliver our homily.
Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. When I think about the memory and the legacy of Bob and Joyce, looking back on what they've left behind, the image of this tree in Psalm 1 comes to mind. Bob and Joyce were two beautiful children of God who saw the world change over the years many times over, and the circumstances of their own lives changed too. But a constant through line in their story is that they were servants of God who delighted in the law of the Lord. The psalm is a promise from God that those who delight in his goodness are like a tree planted by streams of water. I recently visited my childhood home in Abilene, Texas, and I was sad to see that The mulberry tree in our front yard is on the brink of dying. Those who live in Texas know that times now are drier than they were 50 years ago when a lot of these trees were planted, or even 30 years ago when I was a kid. And it's taking its toll on a lot of these trees that were planted in rainier and happier times. This was a tree where, as kids, we used to have secret club meetings. We had a pulley set up to lower a bucket down for our mom to fill with snacks and then raise back up. And I was sad to see that most of those trees' big, generous limbs, where so many of our memories hung, had been pruned away. Now the tree isn't much more than a tall, jagged stump. I live in Austin now, and our house runs up against an arroyo that's usually dry, but after the spring and fall rains, it turns into a gushing river. We go back and forth between droughts and floods in Texas. Our neighbor has a pecan tree right next to the arroyo, and this tree is huge, easily over 100 feet tall. Those of you outside Texas might not be impressed with a 100-foot tree, but around here, that's a big tree. And I imagine this tree's personality standing tall and proud over the other trees in all of our yards in our neighborhood. And a lot of the trees in our neighborhood are suffering the same bad luck as my childhood tree in Abilene, but not this pecan tree. Every summer, it bathes our yards with shade. Every fall, it showers our yards with pecans. And every winter, it serves as a home to a single great horned owl. Now, the difference between this tree and my childhood tree is that my childhood tree had to contend with dense West Texas clay far away from any source of water. This pecan tree has had years to press its roots deep into the rich, lush soil underneath our arroyo. The droughts can come and go, but this tree is still here, unshakable, resilient. God promises a life like a tree planted by streams of water, and we see that promise fulfilled in the lives of Bob and Joyce. Their legacy is tall and proud. I was lucky enough to marry into this family, this beautiful family, that to this day, almost 100 years after Bob and Joyce were born, the deep roots that they put down are still nourishing us. Dozens of us in all corners of this country, and also the countless lives they touched outside the family. My wife, Brittany, she would not be the wonderful, beautiful woman she is without Bob living his life according to this promise of God. Bob and Joyce were faithful. They faithfully delighted in the Lord throughout their lives. And they lived through history where the world seemed to be turning itself upside down every decade or two. The Great Depression, World War II, the space race, civil rights, the Cold War, right up until this once in a century pandemic we're in now. Despite the world changing all around them, their faithfulness and God's promises was unwavering. It's honestly the kind of faithfulness that it's hard to get my 30-something mind around, but they trusted in God's promise. And I look out across this Zoom call at all the names and the faces and just see how much beautiful fruit their faithfulness bore. Their lives were a testament to God's promises. Even as the world continues to turn itself upside down again and again, which it inevitably will continue to do, this promise is still true. I thank and praise God for Bob and Joyce, who show us the richness and the beauty and faithfulness of God's promises. Grace and peace to you all.
Hello, I'm Mark Manassi. I was a student at Pepperdine University from 1982 to 1987, and I worked in the admissions office from 1983 to 1987. I'm thrilled to be able to share a few memories with you about Bob, or as we knew him, as Dean Fraley. In fact, my memories of Bob started quite early. I moved into my dorm at Pepperdine University on a Sunday afternoon, and that evening attended the Malibu Church of Christ And guess who was preaching? Bob Fraley. In fact, I can even remember the title of the sermon. It was The Policeman in the Pulpit. And I remember that message very well, even after all these years. It was a thrill having Bob as an elder of the Malibu Church. One of the things that church members like least of all is the announcement period. But all of us, especially those of us who are students, always loved it when it was Bob's turn to give the announcements, because we always knew there would be something funny and humorous that would help us make it through the announcements. When I worked in the admissions office, I got to know Bob better, certainly got to know Louise and then Debbie, and of course later on got to know Bobby and Jason. Let me tell you, working for Bob was a treat. There was work to be done, but living under Bob's rule was a pleasant experience, or Dean Fraley, I should say. He always helped us, encouraged us to get the work done with good humor and guidance. And in fact, as a ministry student, Bob would also give me advice about preaching and shared with me the fact that he preached several moving sermons. In fact, they were so moving that the elders after church told him he probably should move. Bob even gave me advice about dating and other things about life. And so I am just thrilled to be able to celebrate Bob's life and the gift that he was to myself and so many others. And as we grieve this loss, we do not grieve as someone who has no hope, but we grieve as people of hope. And I am so grateful that Bob was in my life.
A memory I have of Grandpa that I cherish is all the stories he used to tell us about his life in war and his life traveling. And I remember being so fascinated about how courageous and amazing he really was. And it just shows how much of a light to our world he is.
My favorite memory of Grandpa was when I was probably around 8 years old, and we called him in the nighttime as we were going to sleep, and he told us a bunch of his war stories over the phone. For like an hour and a half, probably, we listened to him tell his stories. And it was amazing, and I've always remembered those stories and told them to people. And so it's something that has stayed with me since I was a little kid. I always will remember when he told me those stories.
Hi, I'm not sure how to start one of these, but I'll just start, I guess, by saying that I love Grandpa very much for all of the 25 years that I was blessed to know him, and just wanted to take the opportunity to share a few of the reasons why. First, on a lighter note, I have always loved that every single time I picked up a call from Grandpa, he would say, "This is Bob Fraley." And even when he knew that I knew who it was, even when I answered the phone, "Hi, Grandpa," he would say, "This is Bob Fraley." And I'm going to miss that a lot. And for someone like me, who's pretty terrible at small talk, Bob Fraley was just a pleasure to talk to. I don't think he ever met a stranger, and I don't think he ever sat through an awkward silence. He had a joke for everything. His mind was an amazing vault. I don't know how he was able to do that. And if it wasn't a joke, it was some fascinating thing that he was reading or had been thinking about, and he would just immediately welcome you into his mind to participate in the discussion. One of the things that I'm most thankful for is the deep love and connection that my kids were able to have with him. Not everyone is lucky enough to have that with a great grandpa, and certainly not a great grandpa like Bob, who would really listen to them and spend time with them. Ronan shared with his class this week that he and his great-grandpa had a lot of shared interests. What a blessing it is for him to know that about his great-grandpa. And I really hope that Ronan never forgets all of the talks that he and Bob had, with Ronan asking lots of questions about things like how car engines work, and Bob actually spending the time to give him the answers. I admire Bob greatly. He is, for me, the epitome of why his generation has been called the greatest generation. He could be brash and confident and irreverent and tell a story as well as Bob Hope, but his life is a story of service. Service to his country, to his community, to his church, and to his family over years and years and years. And as far as I know, always participating, always contributing, never opting out, never shrinking from the opportunity to serve. He's an amazing and humbling example of success to me and will be for the rest of my life.
What is the meaning of the name Joyce? I didn't have to look it up because when you say the name Joyce, the only other word that comes to mind is servant. Although I did call her the Energizer Bunny because she never seemed to get tired. I have known her for 17 years, and the one characteristic that stands out in my mind is servanthood. The list is long and impressive. She and my dad lived in Bay City, and their neighbor was an elderly woman who lived alone and whose children lived far away. Every day, Joyce would take a warm meal to her and help her with household chores or stay for a visit and keep her from being lonely. When family would visit the folks in Bay City, she extended a warm welcome. The refrigerator was always full. The beds were freshly made, and you had to hang on to your clothes or she would put them through the washing machine, whether they were dirty or not. If we were anywhere in the car, she always had a bottle of water ready for you to take along. No one was ever allowed to be dehydrated. When the folks lived at my house, she and my dad would come along with me to volunteer at Manna House, a soup kitchen at a local church. And believe me, it wasn't my dad's idea. She was in her late 80s, but she could work circles around me. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner meant that there were napkins on the table, every piece of silverware was used, and no meal was complete if there were less than three kinds of food to choose from. And we always had dessert. She did have a bit of a sweet tooth. When they lived here, she insisted on caring for and feeding the chickens, even wanting to clean the coop, a task quite odious to me. I had very fat chickens. When I went to the horse pasture, I had to sneak away because if she saw me leave, she would force her way in and insist on shoveling manure. You might think I should have stopped her. I would say to you, I dare you to try it. The servanthood Joyce had came from a love of God and her fellow man. She loved being at worship services. She was always positive and upbeat. She saw no fault in others and was always willing to give others the benefit of the doubt. It wouldn't surprise me to find out she is in heaven now, washing the feet of the saints. We love you, Joyce.
When I think of Grandpa, I think of the most amazing stories from the most fascinating life. I was always impressed by his adventures and equally impressed by his memory. He could tell me stories from like the fourth grade, and I don't know what kind of stories I'll be able to tell my grandkids because my memory and my wit is not as sharp as Grandpa's, and my life is definitely not as interesting or adventurous. Grandpa was gentle, with the most patience, as he listened to my sister Kelly and I as little girls sing to a cassette tape of Mary Kate and Ashley Olsen as he drove us in a month-long cross-country adventure in his motorhome from the coast of Texas to Seattle. Thank you, Grandpa, for showing me so many things. For showing me everything from Matagorda, Texas, to Whidbey Island, Washington, the Grand Canyon in Malibu. Thank you for all of the stories, like the Winchester Mystery House, and for the best songs that I made my mom sing to me over and over and over again, and now my kids want me to sing to them over and over again. I remember walking along a beach with you and Grandma as a little girl, and you were pointing out in the sand where there were clams, and I remember Grandma telling me that I reminded her of her as a child, and that is a special memory that I'll always have. I'm going to miss you, and I'm so grateful for all of the memories that I have with you. I love you.
And We have some more tributes coming a little later on in the service. And now I'd like to invite Judy to offer up a prayer in honor of Joyce. So, Judy.
As you can see in the background, I have devoted so much of my life in the last 8 years or so to honoring my mom and my dad and to thank them for their life and their devotion to me. First of all, Bob has been incredibly my dad. His wisdom, his leadership wisdom, his humor, his wit, his love for my mother, his counsel to me when she drove me crazy. I honor both of them with this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus Christ, we are so grateful that you have made all of us in your own image, giving us the gifts and talents with which to serve you. Both Mom and Bob lived their lives serving you. Thank you for my mother's life. Without her, I would not have my children, nor would I have my grandchildren. Thank you for the lives of all of God's children that Mother nurtured, she embraced, and she celebrated. Because to her, that was to fulfill the promise of her life to Jesus Christ for why she was redeemed and saved. Thank you, dear Lord, for my mother's life. Thank you for all of the years that we got to live inside of her love and her devotion. Mom, you gave God your covenant to Bob in sickness and in health. But for you, it's not till death do us part. It is until new life takes us forward. Mom, you've won. And you've given all of us the gift of your devotion and your grace and your commitment, not just to Bob, not just to us, but to Jesus Christ. You truly have lived your faith. Thank you for all of the years, Mom, that we got to live inside of your love and devotion. So now, God, we leave Mom and Bob in your care, assured by your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. At this time, all of us, my husband, my children, my grandchildren, and all of the angels and saints in heaven, all of the friends, the neighbors, the loved ones, the church members, we lift Mother up to you, God, as we join all of the choirs of angels in heaven in singing your praise. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. And now, Mother and Bob, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rains fall upon your heads and your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of his hand. Amen.
My story, this is my song. Praise
I now invite my brother Matt to lead us in a prayer honoring Bob Fraley.
Thank you, Judy, for that wonderful, beautiful prayer. If you would all please bow your heads with me as I read a prayer for Robert. Eternal God, thank you. Oh, Eternal God, you have shared with us the life of Robert Fraley. Before he was ours, he was yours. For all that Robert has given us to make us what we are, for that of him which lives and grows in each of us, and for the life that in your love will never end, we give you thanks. As now we offer Robert back into your arms, comfort us in our loneliness, strengthen us in our weakness, and give us courage to face the future unafraid. Draw those of us who remain in this life closer to one another, make us faithful to serve one another, and give us to know that peace and joy, which is eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Grandpa and Joyce tonight. I have so many memories, so many. Brandon and I, just to lump him in, have been in this family for, married into this family for a really long time, and had the great joy of knowing Grandma Louise along with Joyce and spending so many great years together. And there's so many wonderful stories I can tell, but I think in this moment, what I'm feeling tonight is gratitude, so much gratitude for the impact that knowing Grandpa has had on our three boys, on Levi, Zeke, and Sam, and on Jason. And his story is now their story, and has been their story since he's been telling it so long. And they have so much to say about their great-grandfather and who he was and what he represented. And that's a gift that will hold forever. And to Joyce, who has been with us for so long also, her generosity and joy and love of her family is just something that also will remain forever, and that I hope to always emulate anytime anyone's at my house or any way that I can share love with someone. I'll just think about her and know that carrying that forward is just carrying a little bit of her forward also. Again, there's no way for a minute of words to ever describe all the love that we have for Grandpa and Joyce, and for all the gratitude that I feel for all that they've given to us in our life. Thank
you. When I think of my Grandpa, I think about the sacrificial love that he showed to me and my mom and my sister when they moved to College Station, Texas, and bought us a really nice house to live in, and he helped my mom take care of us. He did that for not only my family, but for other people in our family too. And he was just a servant, and he used the heart that God gave him to take care of his family, and that was what was important to him. One summer, we took a month-long trip in their motorhome across the country, and my sister and I sang Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen songs to he and my grandma the whole trip, and we thought we were driving them crazy, but it turns out that that was probably my grandpa's fondest memory of my sister and I, were those songs. As an adult, I knew that Grandpa was not going to make it to my wedding, and so I mailed him an empty book, and he wrote words of wisdom and advice and love for Seth and I to read at our wedding, and those are things that I will cherish forever. Most importantly to me was when Grandpa got to meet my oldest daughter, Magnolia, and we took her to Tampa to meet him. That's something that I will cherish forever. When I put her in his arms, he lit up with joy, and I could tell that he loved her immediately. We love you, Grandpa.
It's a impossible task to summarize or to adequately express how much my grandfather meant to me. I wrote this down, but it's true. If you know me, then you know Bob Fraley. I'm a poor facsimile of him, although as time goes on, my belly and my chin are catching up with his. But he is genuinely everything I would want to be. A contrarian by nature, a thinker, a faithful believer, a church attender, a singer, kind, funny, sarcastic, intelligent, quick with an opinion, and quick with an assertion of what might be true, even if he has no idea. And that's me, because that's my grandfather. He, of all the things in my life that has been constant, it was him. And I'm 46 years old, and have known him every day of my life until recently. Just 2 weeks ago, we had an hour and 10 minute conversation about politics, about the future of the church, about what it means to look, to be tired, to be old. No topic was off the table. And he was telling me stories about what it meant to be in World War II, and that he can't believe he's 97, and we had an amazing conversation. I'm so grateful for the relationship he had with Joyce. You know, I have a quick story about Joyce. I took Sam, my youngest, to Florida to go see them and to go to Universal Studios as a Christmas present to Sam. And this picture is one of my most favorite pictures of Joyce, because To me, it perfectly summarizes who Joyce is. When we got there, Grandpa was tired. They had not been feeling well, but this is in February. Sam wanted to go swimming and Joyce would not be deterred to going to watch him swim. And so there she was. As he jumps into the pool, she is out there with her coat and a towel to wrap him up as he came out. I'm grateful for their relationship. I'm really grateful for their companionship and the way they deeply loved and cared for one another. I am really sad that he's gone. I am deeply, profoundly grateful for the memories I have of him. I'm grateful that he is no longer afraid. He was worried about leaving with things unsaid and undone. And he left the way that he would have wanted, together with Joyce, living a full life, having children that he loved, grandchildren that he adored, and great-grandchildren he was smitten by. And so for that, I am profoundly grateful. I love you, Grandpa. I love you, Joyce.
When I was almost 3 years old, my father accepted his first ministry position at a small church in Ironton, Ohio, along the Ohio River. The congregation met in an old white frame building, and the contribution the first Sunday we were there was $14. Dad worked for the church as a full-time minister, although they couldn't afford to pay a full-time salary. Being a skilled carpenter, he supported his family through cabinet making, and not only that, he began a program to build a larger, newer brick building and remake the white frame structure into a minister's home. By the time I was five, I'd been to Bible class and church services enough to know that Jesus was not only a teacher, but also a carpenter. My mind began to sense that there was something important I had figured out and no one else knew. Maybe my dad was really Jesus, come back to earth. I would lie in bed at night and think of reasons why this might be true. Naturally, by the time I was 8 or 9, I realized that he could not be Jesus, but my admiration for him and utter trust in his wisdom and goodness was unshaken. I retained this admiration until I reached my mid-30s. At that point, I discovered that maybe there was something he didn't know or couldn't accomplish. I didn't know what it might be, but it was possible that he could make a mistake. I think I've carried that sense of him deep in my heart through my whole life. He was so funny, so bright, so good at remembering any detail he'd ever read. And if he didn't know for sure, he was able to make it sound like he knew. His manner instilled such confidence, the family grew to call it Fraley-splaining. He was a voracious reader, a constant student of the Bible and church history. He loved to meet people, and the number of people I needed to contact about his death shows to me the influence he had on so many. He liked to talk about his travels. He has been to at least 20 countries and had experiences that enriched his philosophy of life and human relationships to each other and to God. He loved the Word, the Church, and the history of the Restoration Movement, Pepperdine University, his family, Pepperdine basketball, his colleagues and students, Pepperdine baseball, any kind of automobile or motorized vehicle, Pepperdine volleyball, and well, anything Pepperdine. I've been blessed beyond my ability to understand or express. He was a faithful Christian, a faithful husband, and a constant servant to others and to the Lord. No matter where he was in life or how weak or strong in faith, he was always led by the Word. So in a way, my 5-year-old self was right. He may not be Jesus, but I know that Jesus dwells in my Father. Jesus' Spirit is in his heart, his mind, and his soul. And for that, I thank God. And I thank Robert Leland Fraley. I'm so proud to call him my father.
When I think about Joyce, I think about endless energy. Such a drive to serve others, and to show love for one another, I always love visiting because my laundry would always be done, even if it was clean in the first place. Belly always full, delicious meals, and I was just always blown away by how hard she could work, and she seemed to enjoy every moment of it. She had such a servant's heart, and I'll miss Joyce and love her very much, and I'm just so thankful for Joyce that they found each other and could be with each other until the end. As I sit and think about what my grandpa means to me, it's obviously impossible to put into words. So I'm not really going to attempt that. But I started thinking about some of my fondest memories, which start with driving from Texas in the suburban to California to stay with them and visit them, and just the overwhelming smell of jasmine blooming in Malibu, and visiting Grandpa on campus. And some of my favorite memories from that time is every year being there for Christmas, and then Santa Claus would come, and every year Grandpa would miss it. And he would come back after Santa Claus left, and I would get so mad and frustrated that he missed it again. And then one year realizing that, wait a second, Santa is Grandpa. Grandpa's dressing up as Santa Claus and being in on that secret. Also, we'll never forget watching Werewolf in their living room, and at the scariest part of the movie, Grandpa sneaking up on me and grabbing me and yelling and scaring me half to death. Then also sitting on the back of the MG, sitting on the little cargo carrier, and going down the hill at Pepperdine, and Grandpa slamming his foot on the clutch, pretending like the brakes went out and scaring us half to death. You know, I think those experiences really shaped me in a way, and the way I interact with people. So I think that's one reason why I got the nickname the Annoyer when I was a kid. But more than that, I think my grandpa was a man who always looked for the good in people, always had a good sense of humor, always, you know, quick to share a good joke and make people smile and feel good and laugh, and always had incredible insights and deep understanding of things, and that I will always remember and appreciate, and yeah, I already miss him a lot.
Some of the best memories that I have from Nanny were when I was lucky enough to work in Seattle for 3 or 4 months, and I could drive up to Whidbey Island and spend the weekend with Nanny, and she, as usual, would take me to the grocery store and fill me up with groceries to bring back to my home. And she was always feeding, always had a plate in front of me, but she was so genuinely happy to have me there and for me to visit, and she took care of me as best she could. And that was, 20 years ago now, but I still remember the great time we got to spend together. And I'm gonna miss that from having that in my life.
Hi, Nanny and Bob, it's Marie, your granddaughter. I just wanted to participate today in the tribute for your guys' amazing, amazing lives. And just let you know that I'm grateful for all the time that we got to spend together. And Bob, we appreciate what a great part of our family you became. But yeah, I'm grateful for all the memories of the last 41 years of my life that I got to spend with you. And especially the last 6 years of my life since I had my kids. And I'm really grateful that, you know, they got to know their great grandparents and you got to know them. That's a really remarkable thing. I definitely find comfort in knowing that you passed together, and I'm sure you're both there smiling down on all of us now. I'm sure all of us, any of us, would take a couple of guardian angels in our corner. So, I love you. My kids love you. We'll definitely miss you for sure. But I know that someday, hopefully not too soon, someday we will get to see you again. So in the meantime, we'll keep our memories of you and just think about all the great times that we had. Love you guys very much. Bye-bye.
Been in the shop today. This is a place I think where I feel the closest to Grandpa Robert Fraley. When Matt and I were really little, we used to go in his garage, and it's by the grace of the Lord that we have our eyes and fingers and all of that. He didn't really give us safety training. He just kind of let us play with stuff. So one of our favorite things to do was to get his vise, and we would get nails and set them in the vise perpendicular and wind it up like that. And then there would be this critical moment of tension in the nail that would just send it flying. We would never know which way it would go. And we just loved it. No safety eyeglasses or anything, just flip-flops. And so Grandpa came in, and we think, you know, we're bending up all the screws and nails in the vise, just having the time of our lives. Instead of getting mad, he came out and he goes, "Hey, you guys ought to check this out." Went over to his little, probably half horsepower grinder, got it turned on with a coarse wheel on it, just showed us how to make sparks with anything metal. And boy, that kept us busy probably until we hit puberty. When I was about 8 years old, and they were at the house in Woodinville, they had a felled tree. When it went down, my grandfather, Bob, said, "Come here, I want to show you something." So he showed me a steel wedge and a sledgehammer. He showed me how to split logs with a sledge and a wedge. And he hired me to cut all that wood. And I tell you what, I did that at 8 years old until my hands bled. I was just hooked. And it was actually during that time when I drank my first full can of soda. It was a dad's root beer. And it was kind of, it felt like a rite of passage for me. Anyway, I think that's where my love of wood and working with my hands came from. So from a young age, I learned to love working with my hands and being close to my grandfather, splitting wood. And funny thing is now, after getting a degree in religion from Pepperdine, that's what I do now, is I work with wood, mill, and I take fallen trees and cut them up into slabs, and then I do custom woodwork, make tables, and I think that's one of the ways I feel closest to him. Grandpa's death, ever since I learned of death as a child, has been the death I've been bracing myself for. I used to pray every night, probably for 2 years, that Grandpa wouldn't die until I died. The longer he lived and the more responsibilities I have, a couple kids and a wife, I'm like, ooh, hoping that doesn't come back to bite me. He was everything to me. I think a lot of places in my heart from having a broken home, broken family, were mended by him. In his goodness, he is the aroma of Christ. When I think about the kingdom of heaven, it feels like being in his home, in his presence.
We've come to the end of our service, and thank you so much for being here. And just really appreciate all of you bearing witness to the life of my grandpa Bob and for Joyce. It really means a lot. It really does. So thank you for taking the time to be here. And finally, we're going to close with a prayer and benediction from Tom Robinson, who is the senior minister at the Manhattan Church of Christ, who Tom and Joyce loved. Every time I would talk to him after he'd listen to Tom's preaching, he would say, "Now that is expository preaching. That is real preaching. That these people, the rest of these people don't know any preaching." You know, he would just go on. So it's an honor to have him lead us in a benediction. Afterwards, you don't have to we can stay around and say hi. And we're going to leave the Zoom room open until people need to leave. But also, if you need to leave, don't feel bad about leaving. So thank you so much for being here. Tom?
First, I just want to express my gratitude for being invited to share in this time. I have just loved all of the tributes to Bob and Joyce that have been shared by all of you. If you don't mind, I want to say just a word. I loved Bob before I ever really knew him because he was already in my life through Jason and Beth, who have always been just such amazing blessings in my life. And it's, as Jason said, you know, he kind of is a younger version of Bob in many ways. And every interaction with Bob that I've ever had has always been thoughtful and funny and always encouraging, so that in my ministry, he has been just one of the most encouraging people that I have had the pleasure of interacting with. I also love the fact that to get to share all of these memories, because it helps me get over a little bit of my anger that it was COVID that got Bob and Joyce. I wanted them to make it all the way through this pandemic so badly. But at the same time, now I'm reconciled to it. There's a verse in the Bible that I've always found to be one of the most startling verses. And that's 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3, where Paul, as he's teaching the Corinthians, just throws in this little observation. "Don't you know that we will judge angels?" And I've never really known exactly what to do with it. But as I think about Bob especially, but Joyce too, Bob right now may be running a school for angels to help them to be more encouraging and to have a better sense of humor, and helping them to be the kind of encouragers that they ought to be. And I don't know, maybe Joyce is teaching sailboat construction and sailing on those eternal oceans. And maybe there they go through tremendous storms and come out on the other side into the sunshine. Certainly, I look forward to that time when we'll be together again. And so let's join as we come to the conclusion of this time in a time of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you, thank you, thank you for these two lives, for their nearly a century long of life and adventure and joy and teaching and encouragement for the way that they allow us to see what it means for your Holy Spirit to live in the lives of people. The way they teach us through their faces who you are, by seeing the impact that you have in shaping their lives and giving them joy through so many changes, in helping them to serve unstintingly, in helping them to shape the lives of all those around them for good, and helping them to live every moment that you gave them, and with joy, full of years, surrounded by love, to come into your presence and to be with you. Father, we thank you for their lives. And as these testimonies this evening have shown us, for the way in which their influence lives on. I think so much of all of those students that Bob has touched, that there are across this world thousands of people who have been influenced by him, thousands upon thousands, and that influence multiplies day by day. I think of Jason and Beth and Bobby and all of the grandkids and the way in which their lives live on in them. But Father, I thank you for the joy that you have in them yourself. You are their creator. You loved them before they were born and every moment through their lives. And now they experience your love in a new and powerful way. And we, with them, await that astonishing transformation of the resurrection, when we will know your creative power in a new and wonderful way. They have lived with your Holy Spirit, with Jesus, with your presence in their lives all the way along. And they will journey on into the uncharted future of what adventures lie before them, what joys, what relationships, what conversations we will have. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the fact that you have also loved us and allowed us to know your blessing through these two wonderful people. Help us, Heavenly Father, that we may live as they did in your love, in your grace, reflecting your love out in service and joy and encouragement to people all around us, that all may know of your astonishing love. We pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.